With over half of enterprise security budgets going towards detection and response in 2020, the challenge is investing in solutions that can migrate and scale with your business. ExtraHop helps security teams spot threats up to 95% faster and respond 60% more efficiently in hybrid and multi-cloud environments with cloud-native network detection and response. Kick the tires in the full product demo at securityweekly.com/ExtraHop.
Welcome back to Business Security Weekly. I am your host, Matt Alderman, joined by Paul Asadorian and Jason Albuquerque. Join the Security Weekly Insider List for webcasts and virtual training announcements and to receive your personal invite to our Discord server by visiting securityweekly.com/subscribe. There's lots of buttons to click on that page now. You can join the Insider List, join Discord, and you can subscribe to any of the shows. All through a nice little new clean interface. Also, do you have a specific guest or topic that you want us to cover on one of the shows? Submit your suggestions for guests by visiting securityweekly.com/guests and complete the form. Paul and I will eventually get to them, I promise, in the next week or two. We keep skipping that meeting on Fridays.
Me too.
We're so busy. Yeah, we'll get back to it. All right. It got my articles in here, and it was the week of sevens, Jason. It was not only
I'm playing the lottery.
I have three stories with sevens in them, but there were at least two more. They're like the seven effective habits of blah blah blah, and there was a seven somethings of.
I think seven, and this is a leadership lesson, communications lesson too. I've always been schooled on the rules of three.
It doesn't always work out,
yeah. But. I do like three because I really do think people can take away 3 points from a communication in a presentation slide. Like three is a good number. Mm. Better if it's even one or two, right? But often you end up with three. So seven to me is too many. In top 10 lists, that's too many, right? I want it distilled down in threes.
Yeah, I know.
There's some science behind that, but I don't know.
The baker's dozen list.
from a marketing perspective, it's always been three. It's just three. You can remember three things. Humans can memorize them pretty easily. If you can put your whole messaging framework into three major buckets, you're good. Mm-hmm. Seven, yeah, it gets a little, but there were articles of seven all over this week. So I pulled out a few of them. First one are the seven keys to effective leadership in our new normal. Now, this would be any normal. It would be any normal. That's what I was. Yeah.
Yeah. I don't know that the new normal drastically changes your leadership.
Leader is a leader.
I mean, but that's, I think, to kind of not look too deep in it, but the true testament of a leader is you're going to deal with whatever the circumstances are with your team, right? 100%. Like, it is what it is, right? Yeah. There are things that are outside of your control. The rest of it, as a leader, basically you need to take ownership of,
100%.
Right, and work with your team. Yeah. I mean, that's basically, you could summarize a lot of these articles on leadership into those things, right?
Totally. Right. These are things we should have been doing pre-pandemic anyways.
100%.
Right? And so when the article says the new normal, it's like, no, it was should have been the previous normal. These are all good traits that a leader should have anyways.
Yeah.
Now's not the time to make the excuses. Well, now you need to over-communicate or you need to be transparent.
That's right. But
yes, you needed to be that way before.
Right.
Absolutely. These are all different traits that a leader should have employed in person, remote. Mm-hmm. No matter what their situation is. I mean, at this point, if you haven't, start honing the skills, because when people do get back into the in-person scenario, you'll be there. But at the end of the day, these things are core leadership principles that you need to be following.
I over-communicate. I want to dig into a little bit because I want to give the article the benefit of the doubt. I think as a leader, you need to know when and how often and what to communicate, and that's going to vary throughout the day and vary throughout the members of your team, right? As we've talked about on previous shows, each team member operates a little differently, right?
Yep.
But I think when you are working remotely and everyone is working remotely, what I would recommend in the kind of term of over-communicate is make sure that your communications go out and are seen by everyone, and don't be afraid to go send out an email, maybe put something in the Zoom meeting and mention that, maybe put something out on Slack. Like, we're all using these technologies more and more because we're not in the office together. We can't just go pop by and say, hey, you don't forget, like, you know, this is coming, right? Just wanted to make sure that, you know, reminding you that, like, this is coming, or, you know, this is the goal for this week, right? Over communicate by maybe put that message in Slack, mention it on your Zoom call, just so people see it, because you're not in the office communicating. I also think that we're not going to all be working remotely forever. I think that's the thing.
Right.
Like, eventually, things are going to come back around, because there is value in being in the same office.
Oh, 100%. Yeah. And I think at this point, you just have to adjust your communication methods, right? Because I'm a big drive-by kind of guy. Mm-hmm. I like getting up, going to see people, having face-to-face, absolutely, being able to have those conversations. Now my drive-by is, doing a virtual call, video meeting, or something like that. Like, just on the fly. Hey, I'm going to ping you in a second. Yeah. Boom, video call. Yep. And have that conversation like you would on a drive-by, right? But, I mean, these are core things. Like, you have to make sure that you care about the people who work for you. Well, yeah, of course. I mean, it's building the relationships. It's being honest. It's being transparent. It's building that trust. Yeah, of course that's something that you need to do in the new normal, but you should be doing that in any normal.
I work with my kids on this, too, on leadership lessons about taking ownership, right? Because I really, truly believe probably the most important thing about being an effective leader, being a good leader, is taking ownership of things, right? And we 100%. All see this with our kids, too. Like, oh, my brother messed up my room, or, like, I didn't do that, or, no, you guys need to take ownership.
Own it.
Like, that's to start at a young age and make them realize you got to be responsible, and that means taking ownership of things, right? Leaders have to do that at just an overwhelming level, right, of taking ownership
of
things.
Agreed.
This next article ties into part of the conversation we just had with Carlos, right? Mm-hmm. How CISOs can play a new role in defining the future of work. And here it's talking about, spend more time with the C-suite players and shift the focus away from, your team to the company as a whole. That being that business leader. My guess, my question, Jason Moore, is, how effective can you be right now in doing some of this with a lot of people being remote? Sure. Can you effectively do this now, or is some struggle still here trying to engage the broader company?
I mean, there'll always be struggles in pockets, right? But I think, again, if you can transition how you would have normally managed your relationships with other business unit leaders, you can do it remotely very effectively. And to be honest with you, I'm finding it's getting easier to get folks on meetings remotely. Like, I'm able to lock in other senior executives' time easier than it was in person, right? Because I do my normal drive by the senior vice president of services office and the door would be shut.
Mm-hmm.
But now, we use Microsoft Teams. Mm-hmm. I can see when he pops green and I can get an alert when he pops green and boom, I can ping him right out of the gate, right? So it's like, all right, wait a minute here. I can start, getting that communication a little bit better. And I think they're a little bit more, executives are starting to be a little bit more open with their calendar. They're not guarding it as much as they used to.
Well, yeah, because we're not traveling to offsite meetings. You go to conferences. So it does have that trickling effect where it actually is pretty, it's easier now to meet with people because there's not a whole lot of other stuff going on.
Yeah, our execs aren't traveling like
they
used to.
The three of us, right? We're not traveling to conferences and going to, one day. And I miss doing that, believe me, because I do think that in-person communications is really, truly the way to build relationships, right?
Agreed.
Which are so critical to all aspects of business. Mm-hmm. But in times of a global pandemic, that's not possible.
You know what? You adapt. Right. Adapt and you try the best you can to use the tools that you have available and the skills that you have to keep that momentum going and just keep doing it.
Yeah, you're not going out to lunches. You're not going out to events. I mean, you got plenty of time now for meetings. I was also curious about, that last one was hire globally to expand the team.
Yeah.
Have you started to look outside for, talent now?
100%. Yeah. I mean, I think this has opened up the eyes of some executives to say, you want to know what? I'm a little bit more comfortable having folks on my team who aren't in the office all the time. So I am starting to see that trend, not just with us, but with clients. Our customers are starting to hire outside of the four walls and really expand and get out of their comfort zone and realize there's a whole set of talent out there that they haven't been exposed to because they were so parochial in their hiring methods.
Depends on the country. Countries carry different security risks, certainly. But if we're all working remotely effectively and you've adjusted your security posture accordingly, I mean, why not? The other thing with hiring, I don't know if that was recommended in the article, but I've been with quite a few companies. Mm-hmm. It's a lot of paperwork. And usually the company has to progress to a certain size to have the staff to handle the paperwork. And the different levels of working remotely.
I mean, take that hiring globally and align it to the size of an organization and just say, all right, well, if you're not a global organization, maybe hire across state lines.
Yeah, start with that. That is its own paperwork. Right?
So I'm just sitting there saying, you know what, this can be taken in context and just say, get out of your comfort zone with your normal hiring practices.
I got visibility when I started early on in my career. When I went to work for the lottery company, a global company, and it was a huge contract company in India.
Yep.
And I get to spend a lot of time with those people, and a lot of the just conversation, again, we were in the office, we were talking, which doesn't happen as much today, right? But, you know, some of the conversation would be around, like, how that whole process works and how the paperwork works. And I was like, oh, my God.
That's a lot.
That sounds like a lot of shuffling, and those of you that have done it know, right? So it just, you're going to be aware of that, basically.
Sure. Yep.
Yes. This next article, as I was perusing just general news, this article popped up.
Oh, my God. I nearly spit out my coffee when I read this article.
The office is dead. Get yourself a backyard shed.
Get a she shed.
I have. Right. I have an underground bunker. We call it the underground.
You do.
It really literally is under my deck. It's an underground bunker. Yeah. It's separate. I go in there. You saw me last week. I was broadcasting from there. And I do agree with the article in that if you are going to work from home, having a space that's separate from the house. Now, not everyone has that luxury, and it's not easy, and that's why people are ordering these sheds. It's actually a few hosts that have, you know, sheds and stuff like that. It's hard, but if you can do that, it is like you're going to work during the day. But not everyone's going to be able to pull that off. Look, people that live in different cities across the world, you don't always have that luxury of, oh, I can just stand up a structure on my property, right? Like, and that's expensive too. I mean, I think
it was like 10 grand or something.
Yeah, $16,000 or something
like
that.
$10,000 was the entry.
I mean, if you're planning that in your property, that's cool. You want to have a man cave or a separate outdoor area, and that's, you know, within your means, and you want to do it, that's cool. I don't know. I also think shared workspaces are going to become a thing as well.
Oh, they will. Oh, yeah. 100%.
Yeah, but I mean, these are the things I talk to a lot of my friends. They're worried about, look, my employees didn't have an office at home, that if they stay in a remote situation, it's difficult for them. I thought this was a very interesting solution. You align this with a tech company and you drop in like all the technology gear in it,
right?
Drop ship these sheds. I'm like, yeah, that's pretty interesting. But to Paul, to your point, I think you're also going to see the shared workspaces, places where people can go and get together and meet and do things. I know, like here in Colorado, Silicon Valley Bank just built a new branch downtown. But part of what they did is they put a ton of conference rooms for their clients to be able to use, to schedule, to create these shared workspace environments, maybe because they don't want a dedicated WeWorks facility or something like that. Yeah. I thought that was really interesting.
It's going to take time before the pandemic opens up enough to use those spaces, though. Sure. I think in a lot of cities across the world, it's just not feasible. You can't have a, you know, open space when now you've got, you know, 50 people all coming in from different parts of the state, right? For as an example, you know, that's one of the concerns, you know, with COVID-19, of course. But I do think as things start to open up, you're going to see more of that.
But flip the coin, right? I mean, we've talked about it on the show before. A lot of organizations are actually looking to slim down their footprint, the brick and mortar footprint, because of this, because they realize I don't necessarily need this building.
Right.
Right. I think things like this are going to become a little bit more popular, right? As you know, organizations start slimming down, and you know, I am a firm believer in no matter what, you need to have your quote unquote commute to work and your commute home. It's just kind of like a mental switch that allows you to get in the game and then out of the game, right? It's you have to have your process,
right?
And if that's waking up, grabbing your coffee, and going to your office in the basement or your bonus room above the garage or the shed in the backyard that you've outfitted to be an office, whatever that case may be, I just think it's really, really good to have that commute, let's call it. And more of a mental commute than anything.
Right.
Yeah. Right. Yeah. You got to keep that, and part of it's separation between personal and work too. You have to, you have to do some separation there. Yep. Otherwise, you're just
burnout all day long.
Oh yeah,
big time.
Bonkers. The next seven elements of an enterprise cybersecurity culture. I think we know most of these. You know, leadership, cross-functional liaisons, education, etc. You know, attitudes and behaviors. We've talked about aptitude and attitude for a long time, right? And
absolutely.
You know, that one definitely popped out. Is one of the big ones here.
Yeah. I mean, for me, I kind of boiled it all down to like three. Resilience of your organization, influence in habits, creating good habits, right? And that influences the relationships, it's the trust. And then habit, muscle memory across the entire organization, whether it's someone working in, you know, accounts payable and finance or within your HR department or your security professionals or IT professionals, it's creating really good habits, right? So it's really those three things that you can kind of.
And that ties into the next story, Jason, right? Around people-centric cybersecurity solutions.
Yeah.
Because how do you do that? How do you continue to keep that front and center, right? Yeah. And they talk about stories and gamification and some of the things that you can use to continue building that kind of culture and that awareness.
Yeah, honestly, out of all of these, I will put stories at the number one. For me, stories are the most powerful thing that you can do.
I think we interviewed Masha Sadova. She said the same thing.
Stories are the most powerful. Yes. You know, because at the end of the day, what we try to do is take our cyber awareness campaigns and relate them to more of the home life. And we try to find those really nice ties between home and work. So that way it really ties it back to what's in it for me.
Yeah.
Right. As an individual. And that's what keeps it and stuck in people's brains.
It can't be too specific. Right.
Yeah.
And is a great example. I don't know if you've been getting these text messages that are like, and my wife and I both have gotten a flurry of them lately. And it's, you have a package to pick up or whatever. Right.
Oh, yeah,
there's these text message spam. And she instantly knew it was a scam because we built the culture around it. Yeah. I never specifically told my wife, you may get a text message that says this, like don't click the link, right?
Yeah.
You have to bring that awareness and training
to
a higher level so that they users know the best course of 100%. Action, regardless of what the threat is, right?
Sure.
That's the really goal that I have for cybersecurity.
I mean, you know as an organization that you're having great success when you have a salesperson raise the red flag on an email that says, here's a purchase order for a purchase. I mean, normally a sales guy's going to be like, oh my God, commission. Whoa, I got commission. And for the sales folks to raise their hand and say, this is not right, that's awesome. That means you're telling the right stories around the organization.
The first indicator, right, and there's nothing technical about it, is unsolicited communications.
Right.
Right. That's like the first, if you get an unsolicited communication, immediately your guard should go up.
The stories, right? It's the stories that we tell of, oh my God, this company that we know just got owned for $150,000 because they fell victim to this purchase order fraud, right?
Yeah, and I agree with you. I like the stories because onboarding programs at the beginning are okay with you in stories, but it's like a shot in time, and then
you
it's over,
know what?
Right? So you have to keep those going.
Here's the thing, though. It all depends on when the security part of onboarding happens. Because if it happens at 3 o'clock on a Friday, how in tune are those folks going to be during the onboarding process?
True.
Do you know what I mean? They're going to be zoned out, ready to get to work on Monday because they just went through a week of onboarding and they weren't paying attention. So it's really, you know, it's really what you do after that. Onboarding is great. It gives a baseline. It can educate if they're paying attention. But at the end of the day, it's how you tell those stories and how you communicate after the fact and just keeping it continuous.
Yeah, because not everybody's a gamer, so gamifying it for everybody doesn't necessarily fit.
Yep.
Maybe they don't want to do the security challenges, right? You got to know your audience, and not everybody's going to get into the gamification or the security challenge side.
That's right.
But everybody can you know, reconcile kind of around stories, right? They it resonates with them a little
100%,
easier.
100%.
Last one, the 7 quotes from military leaders to help you win at life. I love the no guts, no glory here in this one, just because look, if you're not willing to go for it and do
it,
there's no glory at the other end of this. But there's some very interesting quotes in here,
Major General Lee's,
that I thought were relevant, especially kind of in the environment that we're in.
Sure.
But if people want to learn how to, you know, take control of their life, their career. These are just some great quotes
to
think about.
They really are. And I mean, you look at the military community as far as, you know, authors and speeches, and there's just so many out there that you can pull from. I mean, No Guts, No Glory was an actual book, right? By Major General Blease. And I think for decades they used it as operational and tactical operations for, they basically give it to pilots to read.
Right.
That was required reading for them, which is awesome. One of the ones I like was George Coleman and Praise the Bridge That Carried You Over, right? You didn't get here by yourself, right? So make sure you're giving props to to the folks who got you there, and every once in a while say thank you, right? If if you have a leader within the organization who helped you kind of get to where you are, or helped you on a project, or helped you with a strategy and supported you, you know, a thank you, when we can go out for a beer and some dinner or something like that. You know, you always gotta give back to the people who helped you out.
Yeah, bottles of bourbon are big.
Right.
Yes.
Big time.
Usually
big time.
Every Christmas, right?
Yes.
Yeah. There's a couple others. If you find yourself in a fair fight, you didn't plan your mission properly.
Right.
I mean, look, business is cutthroat.
Hell yeah. So, absolutely.
You better be ready.
Lead me, follow me, or get the hell out of my way.
Mm-hmm.
Great one.
Well, that's my wife's motto on the freeway.
That's funny. One that wasn't in here that I pulled out, and I don't know if many folks know about this, but President Eisenhower, General Eisenhower, right, tied to the military, in a similar vein in the 1950s, he fired up Project Solarium, which is all about national security, right? And he had this saying with his leadership team that there's no non-concurrence through silence. And basically what that meant was that when we sit here through our meetings as a leadership team and we're making policy decisions, it is not acceptable for you to sit there and be quiet, say nothing, and then a month from now when you don't like the way things are going, complain about it. I take that one into my meetings and my strategy sessions with my team, with other business units, with other executives. There's no non-concurrence through silence. If you have an issue with what we're talking about now, raise it so we can fix it and we can adjust and we can modify.
Yep.
Don't
speak
just sit there. And be, that's it.
Peace.
Don't just sit there and be silent and ha 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 when it fails, right? No, you had an opportunity to make this better. You had an opportunity to say your piece and help with the strategy. Don't come back later and complain about it.
Yeah. All great quotes. Mm-hmm. Gentlemen, thank you for joining me. Thank you, everyone, for watching and listening. Next week's Labor Day, so we'll see you in 2 weeks on Business Security Weekly.